Coming back to where I was, some of your spouses got pride. They got a pride issue. The one thing that the Lord had me praying on recently was pride, stiff-neckedness. You had to put the full armor of God on them against that stiff-neckedness in order for them to be broken by God, to allow the love that you try and give them, for them to see it and for it to get in to them. They needed your love. They needed to break that. God was breaking that pride in them because they had a trigger that led them to slip into that. And if God was not careful and did not and allowed him, that man to come to you, that pride would have tried to destroy you. In the episode I talk about pride, or the video I talk about pride, I talk about how that pride created a level of fear and anxiety and narcissism in their relationship. Some of y'all God and their spouse did act like a narcissist during that period of time if you were connected to them before. They acted like a person you did not know. I heard to me a stranger in my house the other day. For those that were connected to your spouse. And it scared you. And it took a level of trust in her that she used as a blockade to block the love she had for him, feeling like she could not trust him. I can't trust that pride in you. I can't trust that. I can't trust that. Some of your God-ordained spouses are healing. This is why. Some of them are in isolation right now, going through the healing process to heal what caused that pride in them. I heard, what's his name? Jay Barnett. He did an interview with Shannon Yvette, and he was talking about how he did a beautiful video talking about the pride that men carry and how pride shows up in men and how pride shows up in women. And for men, it shows up in sleeping with woman to woman. It shows up in this nonchalant, non-caring thing. It shows up in a level of arrogance. And God was like, I can't bring that to you. Some of y'all was wondering, begging, crying. Go back and look at my other word where I was talking about y'all acting self-centered. Y'all been out here begging and crying. You didn't want that. You didn't want that pride. Because if they came to you, they were going to show you or something. And it would have hurt and would have cut you. And you would have been in a phase where you would have had to heal before you were able to get back with them. People that need to go through reconnection, this is your story. You're the one that breaks the curse because you're the promise of God to that man. And he is your guardian and protector upon this walk on the earth. But God had to deal with the breaking of the curses. Breaking of the things that were long-standing generational stuff. Things that happened because dealing with their mamas and their great-grandmamas and the lineages way back in the back. Because some of them got history of witchcraft in their families from their culture. I've seen videos from women that they were like, oh, I'm from African culture. And in African culture, if you read the book Covenants and Curses, it talks about those African cultural sacrificial ceremonies that they went through. I was like, some of them have Haitian culture. Some of them have Puerto Rican culture. Puerto Ricans did Santeria. Haitians did voodoo. So it's back there. If it wasn't broken back there, guess what? It's still in that blood. And you praying, you standing, you fasting, you doing is breaking it. So they've been under watch, tied down by the enemy, so they thought. The enemy thought that they had them tied down. Go back and watch my video for Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, where I talk about the character, there was a bomb that was set on their vehicle. The vehicle got to a certain part and they could not drive it anymore. Your God ordained spouse got to a certain place and reached an impasse. They couldn't move any further without God, because that bomb was going to go off. The bomb is actually set to take out the ones around him that is not. Show him who those people were, to get them away so that the ties can be cut, so that he can come to you. Because the curse, in all actuality, is broken because you did that. But ever notice that when you confront a person operating in a narcissistic Jezebel spirit, that the second that they are revealed, what happens? They turn up. They're like, oh, I've been caught. Now I can turn up on you. That's what has happened. And they needed to heal from that turn up. The ties were cut, but they needed to heal from that turn up. The bomb blew up. They needed to heal from that turn up. They needed to heal from being put in the furnace. Trust and Obedience and Imagine Ministries did a word talking about everything in your God, your spouse's life was shaken. And in that experience, they had to come to God. They had to go through deliverance, so on and so forth. And then she did another word recently talking about that your God today spouse had to go through a spiritual baptism, where they were going through deliverance, where they were going through all of that. They had to go through it in order to be healed, made whole, and to walk into what it is that God needed for them to walk into, the redemption. They are going to be redeemed in marrying you, and vice versa. Some of y'all been sitting up there thinking, oh, because they got the influence. They got the... No. Your spiritual walk is going to redeem them. But their physical what have you is going to help redeem you. It's a tandem thing. When this God-ordained spouse in this show came into alignment with this woman, they were strongest together and everyone knew it. There was an episode of the guy's show, Angel, that when they came together in that episode and went to fighting, literally were told they were stronger together. Matter of factually, one of the enemies of theirs that actually ended up getting connected with the God-ordained wife, he said, the line that I remember, let me see if I can remember it off the top of my head. You will love each other, you will hate each other, you will love each other until it kills you both, but you will never something. Because the love between the two of you, it does not matter. When you are ordained to be with one another, all hell could break loose. You could separate. It could... But your hearts are tied to one another. Because God did that. What God has put together, let no man put asunder. God did that. God is in control of this love story. God is working this out. God. 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 But God is doing this. God is in the midst of this. God is building this out. God is developing this. Because God is doing this, what does it say? Let me repeat it again. What God puts together, let no man put asunder. What God puts together, let no man put asunder. What God puts together, let no man put asunder. Just use that as an example. It's come to a boiling point. You got a dang spouse is coming to himself. He's come to himself, and there are things that are needed and necessary to happen in this season. And God has shown them what they needed, and they made the right decision and went with God's direction. They're getting cleaned up, cleared up, and getting ready. They know where they're supposed to be. They know where home is. And they know it's with you. They know it. And they're going to come home. They're coming. They first had to come to him. And now they got to come to you. So I think I covered everything. Is there anything else that I needed to touch on? Nope. Except I could say this, that because of connection between you, you can't even. There was a point in time where she tried to get attached to other men. Like, when they were separated, she tried to hook up with other people. Some of y'all, in your separation from your God-a-day spouse, tried to pull what I talked about in that self-centered message. You saw that other person. You was like, let me try that because they out there doing what they want to do. You tried to get connected. It never felt right. There was a guy that even tried to give her a ring as a token of relationship for trying to connect with her. And he could tell she was distracted because her heart belonged to her God of dang spouse. And he turned around and gave her the exact ring that her God of dang spouse had given her. Bringing furthermore remembrance of the fact. When somebody's for you, they for you. It don't matter. You can go through periods, you can go through trials, you can go through separations, but when God has ordained a thing, it may take time, it may take pruning, it may take experiences. God's way is going to prevail in the end because it's his way, his will, his desire. Because there is kingdom work. And there's a specific anointing for kingdom that is necessary. Can't anybody just be in those seats? Your God ordained spouse couldn't just take anybody into his exaltment and anointing. It had to be God's will, God's way, God's desire. People be out here doing things thinking, this is the person that I want to be with. And God's like, I didn't exalt you to get up there for you to hook up with who you wanted to. Solomon. How many different divinated women was he laying up there with? That were not of God. He had all this harem of women. Ain't none of them godly. I didn't choose none of them. But then when he shows them who he chose, then he gotta get rid of all that stuff. All those things. And some of you got a dang spouse that didn't want to get rid of all that stuff. That means they had to change. That means they had to be respectable. That means they had to. It was a journey that this man had to go through before he could even be introduced to this woman. Didn't mean they didn't have their ups and downs. But their love kept them. It was a level of intensity of their love.
It felt Romeo and Juliet-ish. Yes, I know. It was that romance. I love you. And for some of y'all, that's the way it's going to be. The love intensity between you and your latter-day spouse is going to be unmatched. They ain't never felt a love like this. You ain't never felt a love like this. I never knew there was a love like this before. That's not me actually singing. That's just me being funny. You ain't heard me yet. Maybe one day. Maybe one day. But when God does it, all that's going to make sense. And there are going to be people in places that are going to hate you and going to think that neither of you belong together, because they come to the realization that you done took one from them, took one from the enemy, took one. You done took them. God cleaned them up, and now they are working on the side of God for real. And they're walking through a level of redemption every day. I was listening to Trust and Obedience Imagine Ministries, and she mentioned a point by saying, that, what did she say? How did she put that? That they had to learn how to love. They had to go through the process, and in that process, they had to learn. And she also mentioned some of these men went out. They knew who you were. When God showed them, some of them may have known as long as you have known. They just decided that, one, they won't be rebellious. They heard it and they didn't understand that that's what God was saying when it first happened. Two, they thought they had a choice after it first happened. There's this thing about permissive will and different levels of will. And then God saying, this is my decision. Because what God does is he doesn't tell you, no, I'm not going to tell you you can't do that. I'm going to show you what's going to happen if you do that. That's what God does. He's like, all right. You ever see a parent, when a parent tells a child no, and the child want to do it anyway? So what do a parent most of the time? If the child want to do it anyway, what does the parent do? All right, that's what you want to do. All right, I'm going to let you go out there, and I'm going to let you bump your head and do what you want to do. And then I know you're going to come back, because that's what God do. Because they won't be in their own will and want to rebel against God. God let them. And when the time comes, he going to let it press in real tight. And he said, you ready yet? Ready yet? Yeah. That's where some of your God ordained spouses have been. In that press. Because God was like, oh, I'm going to get them. But I got to do this in the time frame that they're going to come back to me in ordinance. Because I'm going to show them what it's going to look like. Because God did it to me. What God does is, if you put a person before him, he'll show you how much unlike God that person is. He will show them. You ever heard in the word where God said he put a spirit on Saul? That killing spirit. He put that spirit on Saul. You're going to hear the microwave. Don't pay no attention. He's going to put that spirit on a person. He put the spirit of Saul that wanted to kill David. Sometimes God will allow a person that you are trying to become really too tight with to turn on you with that spirit of Jezebel. To turn on you with that spirit. Because God will not be mocked, and God will not allow somebody to become a god in your life before he shows you who they are. He'll show you the pride in them and allow you to relinquish them. You gonna let them go, because they gonna attack you so hard. Because God did that. God has a direction, and you gonna go in it. You gonna roll in it. Especially if you want a his. You gonna go in it. You ever see that parent who tells a child, this is what the way in which you should be going, and the child be like, I'm gonna go and rebel, and then the child go run and jump and bust their head, and then they come back and be like, yeah, they went and ran and jumped and busted their head, and then it was like, okay, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to do that. And then they got to come back and be redeemed. Some of them in relationships, some of them in business opportunities. But it's all going to come together in ordinance the way God desires it. The way God wants it. The way God needs it. Because this ain't their show. This is God's show. And he's going to get the result that he wants. Or he will pull them down and raise up another. So either way, it's going to end up badly. If they choose not to go in the route God wants them to. They can think that they're going to marry that person, but they're not going to have the life that they thought that they was going to have, because God going to pull that person out of the way and put the person that's attached to, who they need to be attached to, in that position. And they're going to end up watching from a distance. Oh, so either you do right or you do wrong. But these men have made the decision to be redeemed. But some of them feel like they got to go through an entire process. I'm reminded of, and I heard this song the other day, the Darnell Jones song. Where he talked about how he needed to go and see what it was like out there before he came back. Some of your God-ordained spouses, they separated from God to go see what it was like, and they experienced all these other things, divinations and all of these other gods, because they were amongst people that were into those things. But remember, in the word, it talks about that phase where God, before he let the children, was the children of Israel? Don't go in there and become friends with them. There was a reason why he said that. Because they're going to lead. I was listening to a young woman the other day, and she was talking about she wanted to gain more knowledge after she came to God. So she started to explore and research other things. And she wanted to be an open-minded Christian. And after having that experience, she said, you know what? I ended up coming back to God in the Bible. I most certainly came back to God in the Bible. Because there was no God in that. Everything else led back to God. Even what they were talking about was a divination of what God was. So I should have might as well just went back to God. That's what some of these people had to come into the realization of. They separated from their first love. And a lot of them, let's just be honest, it was a woman. That Kit Kat led them astray. But they got themselves together. They came back to God. And they're determined they're going to do it right this time. Your prayers have helped them become redeemed. Some of them are out on a mission to do it by themselves. But God is saying, uh-uh. I'm going to need you to do it with that person. Because I have goals for y'all. I have direction for y'all. I have a purpose for y'all. And I know it looks scary right now. I know you don't feel like you're worth it right now. Or worthy of each other right now. But what I have is worth it. I've been listening today. Two words I listened to. It said, you're not going to feel like you deserve it, but you're going to have to take the grace and you're going to have to receive it because God's going to give it to you. A lot of us don't feel like we deserve the blessing that we're about to get. The marriages, the homes, the houses, the cars, the things that God's about to release to us. The blessings, the ease. Doesn't mean you're not going to work, but it means you're going to have joys. But there will be moments. You will have ease, but there are going to be moments. Don't make moments. There are a lot of people that make moments in their day and their life everything. You ever hear of that one person that something bad goes? It was something stupid minor that went wrong. Very minimal. Went wrong. In that little minor thing going wrong, it ruined their entire day. You can't allow one thing that happens in your exalted season that was not what you planned to pull you down, to take you out of position, to make you feel, I fight with somebody right now with this all the time. You're going to have moments. That doesn't mean you're going to need to magnify that moment and make it your whole existence. God's been trying to teach you that because they're going to be moments. But that doesn't. You need to isolate it for what it is and let it go. Don't make a mountain out of a molehill. This message is taking a different direction, but I guess you needed it. Because there are going to be times. You got to realize who's in control. Isolate the situation. I've been looking at, and I guess I'm going to mention this here. I've been looking at the game playthroughs for the old video game Metal Gear Solid. I used to love playing military strategic playthrough games because I loved that aspect of gameplay. Offensive and defensive, tactical moves. This is why I like to play chess. And I was going through each of the trainings and looking at that. Because your marriage is that. You and your spouse, you're on a chessboard. You're going to be going through things. You got to understand how to maneuver that board. Same thing for the military boards of the training. You have to understand who your opponent is, where they are, how you got to take them out. And you're stronger together. These two, when they fought, they were strongest together because they knew instinctively how to fight. It was in their spirit. It was in the core of who they were. Just how to fight these battles. They didn't need. It's the same thing I was saying when I was talking about SVU. The guy knew to pick her up and carry her out the door. It was instinct. It was automatic. There are things that you and your spouse know automatically. It's ingrained in you. It's part of who you are. That's what the enemy didn't want y'all to get together for. That's what he was fighting for. Because he knew that once y'all got together, the way that you're going to fight together, the way your instincts work, the way you move in tandem together, oh, that's a whole problem for hell. The way that these two fight together, the way that they tactically move together, the way that they operated together, could nobody press them in a corner because one had the other's back at all times. If one ended up in a problem, the other one automatically had it. Always. And that's what the enemy is afraid of. Because the way you operate together, you're stronger. The way you operate together, your spiritual gifts and their ability to execute. I heard my coach say this years ago, 6-7 years ago. She said, you take a woman with strategy and place her with a man that knows how to execute, and they're dangerous. You take a woman with godly covering skills and a man that knows how to protect, then take the other two aspects. Dangerous. This is what the enemy's been trying to prevent. Their relationship was under scrutiny the whole time it was together. And any time that the enemy wanted to, even in the books, anytime the enemy wanted to hurt them, they try to hurt the other. But there's elements, even in the guy was a vampire and she was a human being. If something was to occur that, for instance, needed breath, he didn't need to breathe. So it prevented, or he was able to help out in that situation because then he could take her place. There are things that your God ordained spouse can do that can take the place of you where you cannot. There are things that you can do that they cannot. And now that I'm thinking about it, the breath of God, you were the breath of God. You have God in you. Your words are anointed and prophesy God. And sometimes theirs can't because they don't have the breath. But sometimes them not having it gives them wisdom, gives them strategy, and also gives them position in where they are to be able to. They may not have breath, but they may have a level of wisdom that's protective that can get them out of problems. But the two of you, I keep thinking of the little old nursery rhyme. Jack Sprat could eat no fat, his wife could eat no lean. But in between the two of them, they lick the platter clean. There are things that you have that they can't do, and there are things that they have that you can't do. But together, when you work in tandem, you're hell for the enemy. This is why. Coming back to what I said in the other word. It breaks the curse. True love breaks the curse. God ordained marriage breaks the curse. The curse will be broken. The curse will be broken. Your marriage is going to break the curse. Bringing it back to the scripture that talks about that the land was dry, but